The following Conscious Consumer Network recording of a live broadcast is available to purchase in high definition at ethymarket.com. Support free and independent media by becoming a CCN pledger. For 10 euros a month, you can have unlimited access to CCN high definition downloads at ethymarket.com. Ethymarket, the ethical marketplace for conscious consumers.
Good evening and welcome to OffPlanet TV. I'm Randy Moggins. Well, I say good evening, but it could be morning. It could be afternoon. It could be tea time in England and perhaps tea off time down under. Welcome to OffPlanet TV. The websites are offplanetradio.com and offplanetmedia.net. And we are coming to you through the Conscious Consumer Network, CCN. That's consciousconsumernetwork.tv. You want to go over there. You want to look at the lineup. You want to take the baked-in TV player and you want to plaster that onto your web browser and then don't watch anything else. This is all you need. This is all media all the time, 24/7 feed, a radical idea that's pushing out the frontiers of new thought and hopefully a new world at some point. We have a great show lined up with you with Brad Olsen tonight, our guest. And wow, what do we got going on there? We got a siren in the background.
That's a mine. I'm sorry, Randy.
Oh, that's okay. No problem. Well, you know what? I could go on forever about this. With that, I want to introduce my guest tonight. Brad Olsen's on the screen there. He's live from San Francisco, California. And he is a very busy person as well. He is a book publisher with CCC Publishing, and he is a writer as well. We're going to talk a little bit tonight about a number of his books and the work that he's been doing. By the way, I'll mention that he is the event producer in San Francisco of the How Weird Street Fair. So we want to know a little bit more about that. We want to know about CC Publishing. We're going to talk about the esoteric tonight, which is, well, that's pretty much what we do most of the time, isn't it? This will be all the basic food groups tonight. We'll pull all of that in and welcome our guest, Brad Olsen. Welcome to OffPlanet TV.
Oh, thank you, Randy. It's a pleasure to be here. And sorry about those sirens out my window, but it's pretty hot. We're having a heat wave.
It's ambience. I just consider it street ambience. It's awesome. You're in San Francisco. Where in San Francisco
are you? I'm in a neighborhood called the Richmond, just about 20 blocks from the beach. And it's one of those rare sunny beach days here. We usually get a lot of fog. So maybe that's what's going on. It's hot and a drought in California, as you know. And just 40 miles south of here is the Google campus headquarters. And I just want to chime in with a little
Go for it.
About Google, who had a motto which was "Don't be
evil." Yeah,
right. Yeah. Somehow that went out the door. It's kind of like George Orwell's Animal Farm when it started out, "All animals are equal," but then later at the end of the book, it's "Some animals are more equal than others." So, in the case of Google, it's almost like "Don't be evil," but not as evil as the other guy.
Oh, basically, that's exactly what they've done. And you know, it's funny. In contrast, right now, Apple's come out and taken some pretty stiff measures in terms of protecting privacy. None of these companies really have a stellar reputation. And, you know, Google probably now is the most egregious, but it's just the latest gaffe. I was told back in the early 2000s, I worked in the tech field. I was told then that the antitrust suit against Microsoft was a means to coerce Microsoft to basically place backdoor softwares into Windows, all platforms of Windows, including their server platforms, which are used in banking. So, you know, clearly these software companies have all been compromised, or they've compromised themselves for love of money and a pursuit of what I consider to be the New World Order spy mechanism that's being installed.
Well, that's right. And I think a lot of these companies and CEOs, they started out with very good intentions. And I do know that both of the founders of Google go to Burning Man. I've been to Burning Man a number of times. Mark Zuckerberg likes electronic music, and he may have even come to How Weird Street Fair in disguise. But I think what this is really all about is that the NSA or the CIA, maybe some other alphabet agencies, come to these CEOs and say, you're going to do what we tell you to do, or we have ways to make life difficult for you. And it's just a long, dark, perilous road that they go down. And then the next thing you know, what was once a great, ethical, supportive company has turned into Big Brother. And it's just very disconcerting for anybody's paying attention to this.
Well, I know we talked about this in email. You're on a Mac. I'm using a Mac. I love the technology. Yeah. I'm not wedded to the idea that any of these companies have our best interests in mind. And I'm very, very concerned about the devices, especially as they go more mobile. We're now at the place where, well, the Apple Watch has come out, so we have something now that we can wear on our wrist that basically is taking what we had in a box this big 15 years ago and shrinking it down to a 42-millimeter wafer. So, yes. You know, the Dick Tracy wrist radio telephone from the 1960s, it's arrived. And with that, do we really have to pay the price of privacy to have this technology, or do we take control of it? Do we let technology drive us, or do we drive it, is the question.
Well, it's pretty much, if you want to be a Luddite and live without electricity in the woods, it's about the only way you can get away from it. Like I just said, heard that all new plasma TVs come with listening and viewing devices.
That's right. That's right.
Even when our computers and smartphones are turned off, they're still listening and monitoring. So unless you're willing to give it all up and just walk away from it and go live a very aesthetic life in the mountains or woods somewhere, I don't see any way of getting around it. I really don't. And as you pointed out, it's only going to get more intense, more invasive, and worse for all of us. But hey, let's just come to think that if we're not doing anything wrong, they have no reason to come and get us. But maybe some of the subjects we're going to talk about tonight have some people kicking down our doors. I don't know.
You know, well, I resent the implication that I'm not doing anything wrong. In the view of those who are watching, I'm doing a hell of a lot wrong. I mean, I've been, and I've looked at your work, what you're publishing. We're basically subversives in plain view right now. And it is this technology that's left us to do this. It was the computer revolution that began in a garage in California that's enabled us to do this. And I'm not going to walk away from that. The innovation... Yeah. The technology behind this, the ability to do this network globally. We're transmitting over a live stream feed from the Netherlands. You know, here we are on different sides of the country, different continents around the world, different time zones. I mean, you're not going to put that back in the box either. And I think the technology, and I'll just go kind of to the chase here on this question, and we'll kind of maybe just move around different subjects. This technology, in a sense, and this is what scares them, I think, is one of the enabling mechanisms of the advancement of human consciousness at this time.
Yeah. Well, the cat's out of the bag at this point, and any thinking person is starting to see an incredible amount of hypocrisy, contradictions in news reports. If you go a little deeper, you start seeing the false flag attacks, and it's against the people. You know, it's really coming to the point where this is the United corporations of America spelled with a K.
That's right.
Because the corporations have taken over. You know, we just had the TPP that was supposed to have been knocked down last week. Guess what? It just passed. Mm-hmm. And they won't tell us what's in it. They'll tell us what's in it after it goes through, but it's already too late.
Well, I know last week somebody had mentioned that to me, and I said, don't worry, they're going to make another run at this. And usually what they do is they have a false flag event or they have some big news story, pick one of them. They distract the people long enough to turn around and come back in under the curtain of darkness and reenact this. And, you know, the sad thing is, you and I know what TPP is. Well, we sort of know. You know, you have to vote for it to know what's in it. But most people were totally unaware of this so-called fast-track trade bill, which basically gives the president the ability to make secret treaties on our behalf and actually contractually obligate us to terms outside of our own national boundaries in terms of trade and even how we conduct our own business, again, under the umbrella of these corporations.
Right. Well, it's all for the corporations. Mm. They make it sound like it's such a great thing for the people and it's going to create jobs. Really, what it's come down to is everything that I get off of the mainstream media news, I pretty much come to realize it's the opposite. Everything they're telling you, it's going to create jobs. No, it's not. It's going to destroy jobs.
Yeah.
It's going to be good for business. Well, sure, the big business, but not my business.
That's
not
right. That's business. Right. Yeah.
And it just goes on and on and on. So you really have to be aware of these manipulations. And in fact, in my book, Future Esoteric, I do have a chapter called Media Manipulation. And you really have to understand that this whole thing has been perpetuated for decades. And what I mean by perpetuated is the news media is controlled. There were studies, well, there was a big court case in the 70s about Project Mockingbird, Operation right. Mockingbird, which basically said that there are CIA moles in all of the top media organizations. If they want to kill a story, done, it's out, it's gone. Well, it's gotten to the point now, and I will make many references to George Orwell's books because unfortunately I think all that he wrote about, and they happen to be a parody, both Animal Farm and 1984,
right.
are coming true. And these are the things that should alarm anybody who believes in truth, liberty, and justice, because as far as the media goes, they're cramming these false narratives down our throats, and they do it without any sense of wrongdoing. They just, you know, it's their job. Yeah. It's what they got to do. And hey, you want $100,000 a year job giving the weather, you like that job, right? Well, you're not going to report on chemtrails, or you're one and done. Exactly. You're out of here, buddy.
Exactly. Yeah.
And this is one of the reasons why people can't really wrap their head around this, because they still think that in America, freelance journalism is alive and well. And one of my best friends here in San Francisco was the city editor for The Guardian, which was like one of the last true independent newspapers. They could take on PG&E. They could go after big business. Guess what? A company bought them out and they're gone. They're gone. So we're losing all the voices of independent media while the big guys just keep conglomerating and buying up, and it's owned by six corporate heads now. And of course, these decisions are made behind closed doors. They don't give any of us a say in the matter. Sure, you could write a letter to the newspaper or to the TV station, but unless it's trivial nonsense, you're not going to get a say in the matter.
No.
This is about all we got, Randy, right here, you and me.
That's it. Now, you're in San Francisco, so obviously you're aware of William Randolph Hearst and how he actually began the very earliest amalgamation of newspapers. I mean, Hearst Publications basically became one of the earliest that went out and bought outside newspapers and began to operate as a centrally controlled news bureau. I mean, now, I guess you still have Reuters and a few others, but basically anybody that looks at their so-called daily local newspaper now is getting news from no more than two or three bureaus worldwide. So all the news is being moderated continuously. Is there still a viable community? And I look at San Francisco because it's always been kind of, that's the place where it was happening. I mean, it was the summer of love. It's where, you know, all of that happened. Ken Kesey, the acid parties, the Grateful Dead, the Fillmore, all of that stuff. Is there still any remnants at all of independent underground journalism in San Francisco?
Well, it is, but it's all online now. It's right. All moving over to social media. Even emails, doing bulk emails is out. People don't want to be bothered with that. So really, the social network platforms are our best hope, but then we know that they're getting into Facebook and they're manipulating posts. And I've been hacked several times, not only in Facebook, but my own computer had my mouse hijacked and things like this. Even had my lawyer say, hey, type something, and it just comes out gibberish. And several of my good friends know that I have a file on me somewhere. I'm sure you do too. They're keeping their tabs on us. But you know what? I espouse nonviolence, the Martin Luther King, Gandhi variety. I'm not hurting anyone. I pay my bills. I give change to homeless. I'm a nice guy. So what are you going to come after me for? Talking my mind? Writing these books? Okay, well, if it comes to that, then it's game over anyways. So I sleep with a clear conscience every night.
Yeah. I figure if they're going to come through the door and that's the way I'm supposed to exit stage left, then that's what happens. Our producer, friend Biggie, online tonight at CCN, we were talking about this very thing and the fact that you really have to maintain your own integrity, your own moral code, and you have to speak the truth that you know. And I think we're responsible for that. I mean, morally. It's a spiritual quest, and most of the good journalists that are doing work online right now are, they're spiritual people. They're people that have a call to duty to basically pry open this can of worms, let the air in, and hopefully we somehow or another collectively and individually can begin to shift. And I think we are shifting the consciousness of the planet. I don't think it takes huge numbers. I think we're starting to see what one pundit called the tipping point. Are you seeing that?
Well, I am seeing that, and I'm seeing people starting to wake up to the idea that things aren't quite as they seem. I have people that read my books. I mean, my tagline for Future Esoteric is the alternative narrative.
Yeah.
So the subjects that I'm very interested in and have been interested pretty much my whole life, to see a lot of these things come to the above ground and then have people discuss them, and rather than just throw the baby out with the bathwater and say, that's ridiculous, conspiracy theory, tinfoil hat, starting to scratch your head and say, well, you know, maybe you got a point there and we should look into this, and we're not being told the full story. So that, to me, that's encouraging, that people are waking up and maybe there is hope that we can reach some kind of threshold, a 100th monkey type of thing, where if enough people start to really understand that the world as it is not the way it is, and start demanding that the politicians and the people in power take responsibility, that's about the only hope we got.
Yeah, you're right. Talk a little bit about your own beginnings. You is CCC Publishing, what that is, how you got, let's go back to your journey. You write travel books about sacred places around the planet. This sprung out of your earlier life and adventures as a young man traveling around the world. Tell me a little bit about your travels and how that changed you and brought you to where you are today.
Sure. Well, I grew up in Illinois and went on a lot of trips with my dad and my family, and I just loved traveling. And so when I got out of college in 1988, I painted houses and made enough money to go to Europe for 3 months, and it was a wonderful experience. I was very proud of myself. Of course, one or two other friends who said they were going to come bailed on me, so I went solo, and that was fine. Even had my backpack stolen the very first week of the trip in Scotland, and it could have ended right there. I could have just said, I'm going home, screw this traveling thing. Traveled with basically nothing. Fortunately, I did have my camera and my money belt, so, and passport, so I could continue on. And I thought I was doing great. 3 months on the road, self-finance. And then I'd meet these Australians and New Zealanders, and they're like, 3 months? We've been on the road for 3 years, mate. And it got me thinking, how do I do a long-term trip around the world? And it, after I came back, it took me a couple years. I did move out to California and Maui, broke up with a girlfriend, and it was perfect timing to move to Japan and teach English for 14 months, which I did. Mm-hmm. And once again, self-financed a two-year trip after that. So I was out of the country for a full 3 years, and only my dad came over to visit me in Japan. So I hadn't seen any family members or any childhood friends. It's just, and I went solo. And that was the basis of my first book called World Stompers, A Global Travel Manifesto, which is still in print and still does well. And people still tell me they read it and did a trip around the world and are grateful in that regard. So that got me into travel writing. That book is in its fifth edition, so it kept selling and doing well. And that got me into book publishing with another publisher. I did these two extreme adventure guides with Hunter Publishing in the late 1990s. And then I realized, and especially through my good friend David Hatcher Childress, who's also a publisher and an author, that the real benefit of being in publishing is to be the publisher. So I learned the business. I got in with a really great distributor called Independent Publishers Group, who I'm still working with, and they're able to get my books out to bookstores around the world, to other markets, help me with rights deals, and the list goes on. Without them, I would have been out of publishing probably in the 90s. So examining different things that I wanted to do, I did an anthology called In Search of Adventure in 1999. And then I realized when I was doing my three-year trip around the world, which is actually chronicled on a website called stompers.com, still up, you can still see my three-year trip around the world, I found myself attracted to these, what I call sacred places, these really amazing spots, and every country has them, and that's where the tourists flock to, but some are more popular than others, and you can go during off hours and kind of catch the Taj Mahal at sunset without too many people around, things like that. So these places stuck with me, and I realized I needed a new series to work on, and this was back when it was still fairly easy to travel to just about any country. It's quite changed since then, unfortunately, yeah, with two American wars, and yeah, a lot of sentiments have changed about Americans around the world. But the best-selling book in the Sacred Places series is Sacred Places North America. And people say, well, you know, I got your book and I went and found this place just down the road from where I lived. I never even knew it was there, or knew it was there, but never went and visited. So those books did well in their own right. And all the while, I have picked up different authors and published their books. I mentioned Steve Jones from The Guardian. He did a book called The Tribes of Burning Man. And mm-hmm, Lon Milo Duquette did Key to Selim's Key, and several other authors. Now I'm doing a five-book series with an Italian author named Leo Lion Zagami.
Oh, I know who Leo Zagami is. Tell people who Leo is, just in case they don't know who he is.
Right. Well, Leo Lion Zagami, I have not met him face-to-face yet, but we've had many conversations and correspond almost daily. He's, of course, in Rome, and his first book is called The Last Pope. Actually, the full title is Pope Francis, The Last Pope, Money, Masons, and Occultism in the Decline of the Catholic Church. So, not looking to make any friends over there at the Vatican, and I can tell you that's a den of iniquities behind the Vatican wall.
When I was going through the cccpublishing.com website, we'll just plug that right now, that's cccpublishing.com, I saw the title to this book and I was immediately intrigued, because when the previous Pope Ratzinger stepped down, I did a couple of radio shows with some of my friends who are theologically inclined, and we were sort of speculating, was this the scenario? Because it was so unusual that this Pope stepped down, the first time in 500 years that's happened. It seemed to set the stage for something quite unusual in terms of the papacy. And then seeing Pope Francis come on the scene and realizing he's a Jesuit, that he's espousing basically a complete revolution in the way the Catholic Church conducts itself. On the surface, he's giving us this idea that he's very transparent. He's very much a man of the people. And yet at the same time, you read between the lines of what he's talking about, and he's just come out with this latest screed of his about the climate change. And you realize that this guy is nothing more than another liberal recast. He's not that far from Al Gore in terms of what he's espousing. But there's something else darker that lurks behind all of this, including the tick-tock of the clock and the prophecies of St. Malachi that seem to indicate that somewhere around this time we're going to see the end of the papacy. That's pretty fascinating stuff.
Yeah, well, you know the background history quite well, and I'll just add to that by saying Leo Lionzagami quotes many sources, including a underground journalist. Well, he's actually quite popular in Argentina, where the Pope comes from, Jorge Bergoglio. And this journalist continued to tell Leo in interviews, he's a very good actor, and he will do these things to advance this agenda. And let's never forget, he is the first Jesuit Pope in history. If you know background of the Jesuits, this was an organization that was banned by the Catholic Church for many centuries, and were at odds, and they were like the warriors or the soldiers of Christ, and they have an agenda. Believe me, they have a world domination agenda, and now they have their number one guy in the number one spot. And this is what it's all about. They are rolling out, we're going to see it in the next few years, the one world religion, which corresponds with the one world government, which corresponds with the new world.
Exactly, yes.
Mm-hmm. And it's happening. And they've already built their religious capital in this place called Astana, Kazakhstan. And we have pictures of it in the book. And they have a giant pyramid. They have all these other religious type buildings. CNN.com called it the weirdest capital city in the world. And this is where they're going to have their Congress on World Religions. And they're all going to come to an agreement that all religions are one, and that they have the right way of interpreting it all. And they have a ear to God. And you'll see the rollout, as well as a new Vatican. The Vatican II, which we haven't heard anything about in this country, is being built in Rome. And of course, it has the protections of the Vatican, which is its own city-state. It does not abide by the laws and rules of Italy or Rome. It's its own country. In fact, the smallest population city-state in the world, less than 1,000 people. And they have ambassadors to countries around the world. What does a religious organization care about world politics? But this is the background about what's going on in the Vatican. And they're making their big move right now, just like the corporations are making their big move, just like the UN is going to make their big move. And we're here to witness the whole thing. So I just want people to be informed. My motto through all this, and we haven't talked about the esoteric books yet, but it's all about people just having access to this knowledge that people have a right to know.
Yeah.
And I feel very fundamentally, very strong, and I'll take this to the torture chamber or my grave. This is my conviction, and I'm saying it here live. People have a right to know, and they need access to it. So it really comes down to us, Randy. It's the independent broadcasters, the independent publishers, the independent writers, because you're not going to get any of this kind of information anymore in the mainstream media. It's done. It's over. There is no more mainstream independent journalism. You can't do a Woodward Bernstein expose on the president and expect it to get picked up on all the networks. They're not going to do it.
No.
So we have to do it. And the only way we can get through to people is by letting them know that there's a big picture out there they're not being informed about. And let them wake up on their own terms. You know, you can't force anybody to do anything. But those who are hungry for the wisdom and the knowledge, they can find it if they want to.
Well, it's important for people to know that this network, my show, shows that I'm affiliated with, and the people that I work with on the show, like yourself, independent writers, independent publishers, we're not going to be able to commandeer CNN or MSN, not that we'd want to, but we don't have the assets. But what we can do is develop this kind of insectoid mind where we're able to aggregate ourselves and work as small. Robert Fripp, the guitarist from King Crimson, used a beautiful term a long time ago. He called it small mobile intelligent units. He applied it to his theories about music. And I love that picture, small mobile intelligent units. That's what we are becoming. And we kind of come together, we aggregate for a while, we break off, we move in other directions. But in order to get out the kind of information that you're putting out, that I'm putting out, and other like-minded people, we have to break down the conventions, not just of thought, but also the way in which thought is communicated. Publishing is an old industry, but oddly enough, you know, I'm excited when I see books. I'm excited when I see titles that come across my desk and I see what people are publishing, because it seems like, despite the fact that we've seen the failure in a lot of ways of major publishing houses, we've seen the record industry collapse, there's actually encouragement for the arts like writing and music and the visual arts, things like Burning Man and what you're doing with the fair in San Francisco, to promote ideas and to scale that in a way that it's accessible to people again. Somewhere in all of that, there was probably a question, but I don't remember what it was.
Well, I have a quote from Terrence McKenna, the great late Terrence McKenna, who did so much research on botany and consciousness and mind-altering substances.
Entheogens, yes.
Many, many things. We miss him greatly. In fact, I met his son, Leaf. We were talking about doing Terrence's last book, which is still yet unpublished. But it had a lot to do with 2012. It had a lot to do with these earth changes. And his son just really didn't have the wherewithal to kind of fill in the gaps that were required to make this book happen. And it never did happen, but it's still out there. And who knows, maybe I'll take another look at it someday. But Terrence said, we're not dropping out here. We're infiltrating and taking over. And I always liked that quote.
Yeah,
and
it's
in some of these electronic dance music clips that I love so much.
Oh, you know, the whole culture of electronic dance music and, you know, places like Burning Man. I was at Bonnaroo a few years ago and I got to really experience EDM in a full frontal assault. I mean, it's an amazing culture that mixes visuals and this incredible new art form. And again, it's what we were talking about earlier. Are we going to walk away from the technology? Are we going to go back to, look, I like the 60s. I like the music that came out of the 60s. It's nice strumming an acoustic guitar, but I'll tell you something. You get yourself a big kick-ass sound system and guys that know how to work samplers and synthesizers and a light show, and that is about the coolest experience on the planet right now.
Hey, I'm going to go see the Dead on Saturday night.
Nice.
50-year reunion at the new 49ers stadium down in Santa Clara, so that'll be cool.
That's awesome. That's
and
awesome.
I did see them a number of times when Jerry was still alive, so we miss him.
Yeah, we do. Yeah, we've lost a lot of the great ones, but they're still hanging out there on the edge of their spirit. I mean, I want to go into future esoteric with you. And we're going to kind of step through it a little bit. We'll throw some graphics up as you go through the presentation, because the idea is to present the ideas here tonight, and then hopefully people will go and get the books as well. Future Esoteric, there's another title, and I don't have anything in front of me right now. Riff through that a little bit.
Modern Esoteric. Well, this is where the story begins, and this is book one in the series. Future Esoteric is book two, and I'm working on book three as we speak, called Beyond Esoteric. But that's going to come out after all the Leo books come out. So probably around 2017 at the soonest, more like 2018. But it's good because for me, I never want to repeat any material, and I want to see what happens in these next few years, especially this year and next year, which could be extremely pivotal for the course of humanity. especially here in the West and in North America and the USA, because we've just had our midterm elections last November. Obama is a lame duck president. They're ready to make their big move. I think it's going to start this summer with this Jade Helm, and then it's going to really climax in September. Something very big is going to happen. Anything from an asteroid to the Fed's just said it's almost certain that they're going to raise the interest rates in September. And when that happens, that triggers off a lot of other things. So Beyond Esoteric needs to wait. I've had some of my readers ask me if I could fast track that, but I can't. I just need to let things take its course. But the story of Esoteric begins here, because in this book, I cover everything that starts in the way beginning parts of this planet, including the antediluvian civilizations that have once existed here, to the different forms of human-like beings that have lived here, including giants, and moving up to this modern age, hence the name Modern Esoteric. But in it, I also include all the secret societies, sacred geometry practices, get into how this grid of knowledge and power has been set up in the way that it has. And if I can just read the three main sections of this book, start out with secrets, because we have to know what's going on in our age. And the lifeology section continues with all of the mythos of creation, blood of the gods, DNA mysteries, primitive wisdom, rethinking history, lost continents, and past esoteric. Then we move into the control section, which includes the secret families, the changing religion, as we spoke of with the Pope, sacred geometry, sacred symbols, the pineal gland, which has been effectively turned off in humanity.
Absolutely.
If we were able to turn it back on again, we could become interdimensional conscious beings, kind of on par with what we would imagine benevolent space brothers and sister capacity would have, astral traveling, to levitation, to telepathy. We wouldn't even have to be having this conversation with our mouth. We could just be thinking it, and people might be able to pick it up. And in the control section, I also get into the unhealth industry, how we've been intentionally dummied down, given poison, this stock kill approach to making us all die off in our 50s or 60s or 70s, whereas we really have the potential to live to 200. Yeah. And in the section called Thrive, because I am a very optimistic person, I end all my sections on a positive note, and the first chapter is called Living to 200. There's also Science of Consciousness, Spirit, Body, and Mind, Reincarnation, Pre-Utopia, the Buddha, and So You Want to Throw a Street Fair. Which may be a good segue before we get into future esoteric.
Yeah, let's talk about that a little bit.
How I started the How Weird Street Fair.
Yeah.
Which was basically a combination of traveling, meeting a few Americans in India, and going to these Goa trance parties in the early 1990s. All of us finding our way here. And it's interesting that none of us had ever lived here, but we got this great warehouse on Howard Street. And then started throwing parties of our own, which became very popular to the point where we just couldn't let everybody in because it was a smaller space. And then we got some funding from a gentleman named Joe Firmage, who had just sold his business for $100 million and gave us some startup capital to start a nonprofit organization, which is still the parent organization of the How Weird Street Fair, called World Peace Through Technology. And the idea of this is that we would highlight the benevolent uses of technology that could actually be of benefit to humanity. So to just put a nice little bookcase on the beginning of the show when we talked about technology, we have to make a distinction that there is good technology that could take us into the 21st century and beyond, free energy technology, which I also explore in Future Esoteric, and many others of a benevolent nature. And I think we just have to make this philosophical distinction between nuclear bomb and poisonous gas technology that could wipe us all out, or the heart machines that could trigger the super volcano under Yellowstone National Park, to benevolent technology such as free energy and space exploration that could really take us into a Star Trek-like future scenario.
Well, you know, the technology is not what's inherently evil. I mean, other than the fact that I'm not right. a big fan of nuclear, I don't see a lot of good in nuclear. Right. But, you know, if we were able to go back and reassess our priorities and have developed fusion technology reasonably instead of going with fission. That said, and you again, you live in San Francisco, the roots of a lot of the better aspects of technology are there. A lot of people don't realize Stuart Brand, the Whole Earth Catalog, and what grew out of that, the earliest technological adapters, the well in San Francisco, one of the first online systems. Yep. I mean, basically the technology we're using now grew out of the 60s revolution.
Yeah.
Steve Jobs, I mean, you know, the guy went and dropped acid, had visions, you know, and went, crap, I might as well just build a computer, and went off and did Apple. I mean, we are living on the fumes of the 60s in that sense, but the ideology somehow drifted away, which comes back to the idea of the street fair, the bringing together, and all of these events kind of like a regathering of the tribes, the energies come together, people get crazy and creative.
Exactly. And so we were having these very fun, successful parties in the CCC warehouse, and that's where I got the name. That's why I started my publishing business out of there, Consortium of Collective Consciousness. It's kind of our own little tongue-in-cheek sort of jab at, not to say we're smarter than anybody else, but just it's a cool name to it. And then when we got this funding from Joe Firmage, we started the How Weird Street Fair, How Weird, play on words. And it was kind of like us rolling out our sound equipment from the ambient room upstairs to the big bass bins from downstairs and just rolling them out in the street, two stages. And people would come and they'd say, hey, what is this How Weird Street Fair? What kind of music do you play? It was kind of like the line from the Blues Brothers when they go into Bob's Country Bunker and they go, oh, well, we play both kinds, techno and trance.
Right, yeah.
Back then, you know, there wasn't much distinction between electronic dance music, but now there's, you know, dozens of genres out there. And that's what we showcased at the How Weird Street Fair. And 16 years later, we just had our most successful event on April 26. We were over capacity. We don't have to even advertise this event, and people just come en masse. And that's really, for me, the nice thing about doing the How Weird is that I have this opportunity to put a smile on the face of 20,000 people.
So let's kind of dovetail a little bit into Future Esoteric, and this book, again, is kind of a compendium. I looked at I went through the book, obviously, scanning first, and then I tend to read things in very weird ways because I'm rather nonlinear. But looking at the chapters on this, these are all the food groups of everything that I've been doing on radio for about 12 years, and just kind of begin where you want to go with it, and we'll develop kind of a dialogue as we go along on the subject matter, because this really covers all of the things that need to be talked about. It's funny, while we were talking, I looked up the definition of esoteric, and it says, intended for or likely to be understood by only a small number of people with a specialized knowledge or interest. If I understand what you're doing here, it's subversive, because Future Esoteric, basically, if you succeed, it won't be esoteric anymore, right?
Well, it won't. And I'm waiting for the day for all these subjects to be verified above ground media and come true, because you're absolutely right. The nature of an esoteric subject is studied by a select few, to be understood only by a select few. And that's the way I look at these books. They're not for everybody. I get that. But the people that want to go deep with this, that want to go down the rabbit hole, let me tell you, it's 350-page books worth of information that we could, that I've been collecting and putting together in chapters and just basically condensing. I mean, it could be an encyclopedia of esoteric subjects. In many ways, that's how I kind of want these books, all three of them, to be in the end. But Future Esoteric is really near and dear to my heart because this is the book that takes a forward-looking view. And it also includes all the information about UFOs and ETs.
Yeah.
And when you go down the rabbit hole, and every researcher knows it, including Leo Zagami, who is basically from these very well-to-do families, he's got it in there too. They've all got it in there because it's real and it's part of who we are, but it's still officially covered up, still officially not recognized, and it's laughable with the amount of information that's out there that the powers that be, I like the term the powers that were, because they're on their way out, that they can still think that they have us sheeple in this little box that they can contain. Well, the box is wide open. The Pandora's box, once you open it, it's out there. And
you know, what is it about the UFO ET thing? And I guess I'm looking at this from the standpoint of somebody who's, I've seen them, I've experienced it. To me, this was a no-brainer, but it was not talked about. It's still not talked about. It is a taboo subject of the highest order. The mainstream press won't touch it. They poo-poo it. If they do a UFO story, they usually have their little smirk at the end, and they usually, it's like the closing joke of a stand-up show for them. But this is actually huge, because this goes into the consciousness thing of where we're at and why after 1947, all of a sudden, do we have these flaps across the country? What the hell happened at Roswell? What kind of technology was unfolded? And why is it that now, all of a sudden, because of the internet, there's finally people that are beginning to talk about this as a serious subject and not as sub-genre of science fiction?
Right. Well, it took us a few decades to really wrap our heads around this, because what we're talking about here is nothing short of the greatest revelation that it will ever happen to humanity, bar none. Nothing will even come close. Even in the next 1,000 millennial years, it will not even come close. This is the great awakening of humanity. This is the point of time when we are all going to witness what everybody in many, many generations of people had yearned for, to see this kind of thing happen. And here it is, right before our very eyes. Now, what's so very interesting is that we're really walking the razor here. I mean, in one way, we could go to nuclear Armageddon, destroy the planet, bomb us back to the Stone Age. You know, we've heard all this stuff about how terrible World War III is going to be, and I'm sure it would be. Or we can stop that. We can prevent all that. And by the way, that's timeline two. And timeline one is the timeline that we're meant to be on. And that is the golden age. That is utopia. And that's why the final section in Future Esoteric is called Utopia. And this is how we, every one of us, has a responsibility in making this happen. And how we make it happen is quite simply this: our consciousness. And the tagline of the back of Modern Esoteric is "The revolution is consciousness." And I so firmly believe that. And it happens one person at a time.
One of the early titles in this book is "The Fourth Reich in America." Mm. I'm trying to remember now who wrote the book. It was one of my coming-of-age books when I began to wake up to what was really going on in the United States. But understanding that through Operation Paperclip, we had seeded into our government the scientists, intelligence officers, and operatives from the Third Reich. mm-hmm. brought them in, took the OSS, converted it into the CIA, and basically through the National Security Act installed another government into the United States. And I'm guessing that's kind of where you're going with this idea that after World War II, this country was not the same country that went into World War II. We came out of it, and it seems like we installed another form of government that basically operated in secrecy, that basically was working to suppress technologies, existence of other creatures, and the operations of what Eisenhower called the military-industrial complex.
Well, that's exactly the setup for how we got into the mess that we're in and why fascism has creeped into this great country of ours and how our Constitution is getting chopped down piece by piece. A very important distinction to make. The Third Reich never surrendered in World War II. Germany surrendered.
Yeah.
Third Reich just went underground. Martin Bormann, the money man, he went missing. And he popped up in South America.
Yeah.
You know, the FBI vault. And the FBI, as far as I know, they don't put out hoaxes or frauds or anything.
Right.
But we want to cover their tracks in the future if they ever get called on this. Well, they released some documents about a year and a half ago that Adolf Hitler did not die in the bunker. He too went to South America and lived out the rest of his life there. Now, if you got the money man Bormann and you got some top officers of the Third Reich, and my friend Joseph Farrell, who's done many books on this, we've
exactly right. Him. Yeah.
He's great. In his book about the German technology and then creating the Third Reich UFOs, which I'm getting into in
the Nazi bell, basically.
He said that the Wernher von Braun and all those paperclip Nazis that worked in the space program were passing cachets, and they were kind of whispering to each other in German, and they were keeping it going. And as you said in the setup to this, the Third Reich infiltrated this country at the top levels. We're talking Reinhard Gehlen working with the CIA. Right. Okay, he was the top spy man of Eastern Germany. He came here to work under Alan Dulles. Well, the two Dulles brothers, hey, you got an airport out there in Washington, D.C. called
right.
Dulles International.
That's right. Flung through that, baby. Nazi. Yeah.
He was a Nazi sympathizer before, during, and after. Kennedy fired the guy.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and then he headed up the Warren Commission for JFK's assassination. Wow, how convenient is that? Right. So now we know that there was this Nazi infiltration in this country, and they are resorting to covert means of enforcing this Fourth Reich. And so in the chapter, The Fourth Reich in America, I give the basic overview of what it is. But in accordance to the slide you just pulled up, they are working with this elite class. Leo calls them the Illuminati. I call them the Cabal. They're basically industrialists who have fascist motives. And as the slide depicts, they have the army and the police under their ranks taking orders. And unfortunately, we're at the very bottom being crushed by them at the moment. The only thing we can do is wake up. And we have to do it quick because this thing is coming down on us hard right now. So moving on from there into the secret space program, and you alluded to 1947. Well, just keep in mind, the first atomic explosions happened just a year and a half before Roswell, Manhattan Project, and then World War II. And my understanding is that created like a reverberation out into the universe that, holy cow, here the humans have nuclear bombs now. We better start paying attention to what they're up to, because next thing you know, they'll blow the planet up and it'll be like Mars, just full desert and all life.
There's this famous magazine cover, you've probably seen it, and I think it was Time, where they're putting off the A-bombs out in the desert in Nevada, and it's a panoramic picture, But you look in the background behind the mushroom cloud, and there's this gigantic rift in the sky. It's almost like a black hole sun.
Right.
And I've seen that cover. I saw that cover years ago. And I honestly, it chilled me to the bone when I looked at it. And then later on, in doing the research that I was doing for the show, I began to talk to people. And even some of the ETs had told their human contacts that as a result of what we did with those bombs, we were basically reverberating through dimensional space and jeopardizing worlds that we can't even imagine on the other side of a dimensional matrix.
Absolutely correct. And now that science has told us we live within 13 dimensions, and wrap your head around that one, we can only perceive three. And the way I try to explain this to people, just to understand the fourth and fifth dimension, is that there are frequencies and ranges outside of our perception. For example, the way that a dog can hear a dog whistle, but we can't. The way that the ultraviolet is on one end of the spectrum and the infrared is on the other. And you can't see those either. So there could be things right here, right now, in our reality, all around us, that we can't see. Sometimes they get picked up on film, like the archons and the orbs. You'll sometimes see them when you develop your photos. Hey, I didn't see any of that out there. And one time my dad came out to Burning Man and we took a bunch of pictures, and there were just orbs everywhere. I couldn't believe it. You could say, oh, well, that was just dust from the atmosphere.
Oh, but no, I experienced that out in the desert in Sedona with some friends of mine. We took a bunch of pictures, and I mean, it was repeatable across different cameras, different exposure settings. It was phenomenal. And I mean, people that experience UFOs, that there's this whole phenomena, and it goes into the consciousness thing about what our minds are trained to accept. People who see UFOs see UFOs, and they can see them standing in plain view when other people around them absolutely cannot perceive them at all. So that tells us something about the entrainment of our consciousness. And like the dog whistle, the things we can hear, but perhaps through training of the senses, we become enabled to do that.
There was a story of the first explorers coming to North America, including Columbus, when he came to Hispaniola, and his ship was right out the harbor, but they couldn't see it.
Yeah.
The sailor said they didn't see us, and it took them a few days until they started interacting with them. I think that's very akin to the UFO phenomenon. If you're not in a position to really accept that, you're probably not ever going to see that. And I, like you, have witnessed phenomenon, and I know I have a photographic memory. I know what I saw, and I remember it like it was yesterday.
Oh, I can draw pictures. Yeah. I can pull the details up.
Yeah. Well, that's what got me started on the Esoteric series, is because after my experience witnessing phenomenon up at Crater Lake in Oregon, seeing it, just a super bright flash of light that several seconds across the sky, I was with witnesses who said they saw exactly the same thing. And it was as bright as a white laser beam, but it broke off into blips and then just disappeared into the depths of Crater Lake, which we know that UFO sightings often occur around volcanic cavities. Perhaps right. They're entering into the underworld. Well, we were running up to go meet our other friends. It was at sunset. We were hoping that they had seen it too. Unfortunately, they hadn't. But the two other guys I was with, we looked out to the south, and there's Mount Shasta. We saw the same thing right into the mountain. And when I came back from that trip, I just wanted to find out answers. And of course, we can't get those answers. They're not available for us. So that was one of my motivations in doing Future Esoteric, that I really wanted to get to the bottom of this. And I wanted to truly understand myself personally. Like, I did these books so I could understand. And I've always taken the perspective that whenever I publish a book, either my own or another author, this is the kind of book I would seek out. This is the kind of information I would want to pay money to buy and own and understand. And probably that's why I'm still in this business, because other people see the quality in the publications that I do.
I look at these books, and these are books, while they deal with, well, esoteric subjects, paranormal things, things that are outside the range of normal human experience and basically day-to-day dinner table conversation. These books are written that you can give them to people. And if they are open, and this is the whole thing about all of these conversations, over the years of talking to people, I've discovered that intuitively I'll sense when people are open to things. The conversation will drift in a certain way. Somebody will catch you in a certain way, and they'll go, you know, I've wondered about this. And you get the intuitive sense that somebody's open. These books are books that are compendium of information. They're packets that somebody can read. They're not going to have to send... They're written to the common man in a way that's both elegant and very simple at the same time. That's my short review of the writing style and the way that you've assembled these.
Thank you.
But that was your... That's kind of what I get the sense is your goal as well, is that these books are to be passed around, referred, given to people, gifted to people. These are gifts to somebody who's waking up, and there's a ton of them out there right now.
Yeah, and that's why I enable the Google Books app on CCC Publishing 100% readability, because I recognize the fact that a lot of people are broke or hurting right now, but I truly feel I want to get this information out to everybody, even if they can't afford to buy it. So if you have access to a computer at a library, you could read a chapter at a time.
That's phenomenal. I didn't know you did that.
Yeah. Yeah. Leo doesn't want me to do that. So I had to restrict his books to 20%, but that's his choice. Me, I'm 100%. I'm fully open source like you, and open. And if I could, I'd give them away, but you know, there is a cost in the physical producing of this, and it is what it is. I try to price them lower than most books on the similar subject for that very reason. And I hire great designers and editors who enhance it, because what we're talking about are very complicated subjects sometimes. And to be able to condense what each one of these chapters could easily be a book in and of itself.
Exactly.
And to condense that into a chapter that, as you mentioned, is easily readable or understood by the layperson, that's when the esoteric then becomes the exoteric. And exoteric is what everybody perceives to be the reality. For example, it was a very esoteric thought to believe that the world was round 500 years ago. Today, we all know it is. It's exoteric. It's, everybody knows that. And as you said earlier, it may come a day when this will become common knowledge. And I sure hope I can offer my small part in doing that. Because this is what it's all about, Randy. This is who we are as humans on this planet, is to truly understand our role and to take it to the next level. Some of us are more capable of doing that in the way that you and I do that.
Yeah.
And I'm not harshing on anybody. Everybody is working at their own pace. Some people are still waking up to all this. But when we get to that critical mass point, the 100th monkey effect, which I could explain, is this term about a study done in Okinawa watching monkeys in the 1950s, that they used to eat these roots that were seasonal right out of the ground. I'm talking about the monkeys, and some anthropologists were watching them. And quite surprisingly, the anthropologists had the opportunity of watching one of the monkeys, rather than eating the root right away, taking it with him down to the river and washing it off and then eating it. Notice, hey, no dirt, tastes way better. Other monkeys of the tribe
witnessed. No dirt tastes good.
But then quite quickly, all of the other monkey tribes on the other islands in Japan also started doing it. So what this says is there is such a thing as a collective consciousness burst, that when you reach a critical mass, say this 100th monkey in the tribe in Japan, it can then reverberate quite quickly to all the species of its kind, and then people would just start getting it. It's almost like a light bulb moment that there can be this massive awakening very quickly. And it really doesn't make sense in a logical way. Like, how did those other monkeys know to do this? Other than there is this awakening of consciousness from time to time. And I think we're right on the verge of that here with the human race. What I found so interesting, and this is something I speak of in the early chapters of modern esoteric, is we're living on a planet where you still have Stone Age people. Mm-hmm. No, non-contacted Stone Age people in the Amazon and Papua New Guinea. There's not many of them left, but they're still there. We're talking about people who have not invented or know anything other than just hunting and living off the land and just a little bit higher than the animals that they kill. I mean, they wear penis gourds and not much else in Papua New Guinea. I mean, they're very, very primitive people. And at the same time, here I am in Silicon Valley, where these incredible inventions, they say a millionaire is born every day in Silicon Valley. That's because of the innovation. And you have this innovation that's just off the scale. What's more, we have a breakaway civilization of humans that are now living in outer space, and they're the same human race as these primitive tribes. So what my point is, you have this incredible disparity of two different kinds of humans right now. Those who are extremely high tech and advanced and even living off planet, and those that are barely living above an animal existence in some of these uncontacted tribes. So this is really quite an amazing disparity of human consciousness that's happening. And I'm very curious to see if the 100th monkey effect does occur, if, say, these primitive tribes all of a sudden are starting to get all these downloads. Oh my God, you know, I had the wildest dream last night that Joe over there was going off into outer space. I kind of wonder how that's going to all play out.
Isn't it interesting, though, that here we have these brilliant people. They're innovating, they're technologists, they're creating all this incredible stuff. But at the same time, you talk to them, and they're going to Peru to find a shaman to do the ayahuasca. Which technology is superior? Is one better? Is one the same? Because in my view, entheogens, however, you know, whatever your flavor is of that, ayahuasca, that's a technology. That's a technology of the mind, in much the same way that ultimately the computer silicon chip is an extension of our minds, our hands, our ability to create, function, and communicate. So isn't it, it's not lost on me that in some way the two cultures interlock at a very interesting place where eventually we're not going to really, you're not going to need the silicon chip or the ayahuasca. They're all trips to the same place in one sense.
And there will come a time, I think it's already happening, that we will have this yearning to return to the source. And I have a chapter in modern esoteric called Primitive Wisdom, and how some tribes have no concept of money, no concept of want, no concept of property ownership. They just don't know. Everything's communal. Everything is shared. And there will come a time where modern advanced humans are going to need to go back to that mindset. So in a way, it's really wonderful that these uncontacted and primitive tribes still exist on this planet, because I think there's a lot we can still learn from them. And I would also say that their perception, maybe even their ability to employ telepathy, such as when they go hunting for animals, is even superior to our modern mind. So don't think of them as primitive savages, but just humans that are having a different experience. And there is some takeaway that we can gather from that.
That's, again, you know, we tend to live in a culture that, it enshrines itself, but in a lot of ways, it's not lost on me that the simpler things sometimes are the things that bring us back into essence. I mean, anybody that's a serious spiritual seeker, and I'll bounce this at you because I know you talk about this a little bit, going off on a journey somewhere, going to an ashram, going someplace where you can be quiet, where you can settle the mind, where you can go inward. Tell me a little bit about how that works with you. You've experienced that in your travels, the sacred places, for instance.
Well, in sacred places, one of the most profound two-word sayings of antiquity comes from the Temple of Apollo at Delphi, where pilgrims for over 1,000 years made a trek to the hillside of Mount Parnassus in Greece, including Alexander the Great and all the kings of the age. The prophecy that was given to Alexander through a virgin young lady who was breathing these fumes in a chasm of gas that was coming out of the basement of the Temple of Apollo. She said through the priests who interpreted her gibberish, "My son, none shall resist thee." And indeed, Alexander the Great went undefeated in all his campaigns. And on the Temple of Apollo at Delphi are two words, "Know thyself." And to me, those are the most profound two words there ever were, because the journey is all inside. The journey is knowing thyself. And once you become happy with your place in life, I don't care what you look like, I don't care how successful you are, if you know thyself, that's all there is to it. You're going places because you're able to control your life and you're able to control the circumstances around you. And if it's wealth, fame, fortune, notoriety, whatever it is you seek, it becomes so much easier to be in the flow if you know thyself. So my way of doing this is I have no problem being alone. I love myself. I love the company of others, but I can go on my bike or drive to a place and hang out all day in the sun, have a little picnic with my friends. I'm 20 blocks away from Baker Beach, and I know right now it's a sunny day. I've got 50 friends that are all hanging out there playing volleyball right now. It's clothing optional. It's where Burning Man started. And it's my little clubhouse. So simple things in life are very accessible. Simple ways to make yourself happy are available. Don't think you have to have the whole world. You don't. You have to have what's inside of you. And we have such incredible gifts. When I spoke about the pineal gland earlier and other things like our DNA becoming activated and then adopting superhuman abilities. These are all in the realm of possibilities, but they will not happen until you know thyself. So that's basically how I keep my peace of mind in this crazy world where we're just inundated with negativity on pretty much a daily basis. And, I'm a news junkie like most people and follow this stuff. And how do you make heads or tails of the next false flag shooting and chemtrails every day and trying to explain 9/11 as an inside job to people? The list goes on, but we just have to be true to ourselves. And being true to ourselves, at least for me as a journalist, as a researcher, is to follow its story to its natural conclusion. And if it's going down the rabbit hole and it's a dark, deep, weird, infested with pedophiles like the priest thing, that's where it goes. And we're just going to have to make sense of it. And someday forgive these people. Fortunately, nothing like that ever happened to me, but I have talked to survivors and they're just living with a horrible nightmare. And sooner or later, they're just going to have to forgive, because that's really the best way we can make our own personal progressions. Seem to lost your audio.
Sorry about that. That's that mute button that I forgot to. Anyway, it's not lost on me that in a sense we are living in a theater and we play these roles. I struggled spiritually with this for years, this concept that, you know, today my enemy, tomorrow may actually in another incarnation, another life, maybe even in this one, wind up being the ally. And the fact that we play these roles, these are the roles of duality, the roles that we play as we work through incarnation, very morally challenging stuff when you look at people who have been abducted, who have been raped, molested. Basically, everybody on this planet, in my opinion, suffers from some form of PTSD because we've all been assaulted on a psychological level, even as children.
Yeah.
And so you kind of riff through those concepts, and again, writing from your perspective and the travels that you've had and the things that you've seen, what is your take on this theater, on this stage that we're play actors in?
I think you hit it on the head. In a way, we've all been victimized, but we can't play the victim. So it's kind of a paradox. In one way, yes, you have a right to be upset. Yes, you have a right to maybe acquire what has been taken from you. But if you really know thyself, you can't give in to the anger. You can't give in to the hate. You can't give in to the negative emotions, or they will consume you. And when they consume you, they will shut you down emotionally from making very important advances that you can pursue if you're able to forgive. And I really think that this is the key word here, because so many people hold grudges, hold animosity towards their parents or their siblings or people they grew up with. And I don't know how many people I know that, like, oh, I haven't talked to my dad in a decade. It's like, yeah. I can't imagine that. I love my family so much, and I look forward to talking to them and hanging out whenever we can and just going through life as a shared experience. And sure, things happen when you're a kid and you may feel slighted in such a way, but come on, really, we can't be the victim anymore. We just have to move on, and we really have to embrace love. And it took me a long time to say that publicly and really feel it, but that is what it's all about.
I've talked to a lot of people, and there is a zeal amongst the people of goodwill to want to take back our world, to take back our governments, our institutions, our media, our financial institutions. And yet at the same time you go, but wait a minute, what happens on the day when we seize back power and we have to deal with these people who, you know, have been ruling over us for a long time? And, you know, for a long time I was of the opinion, well, some of them frankly need the blindfold, the cigarette, and the first class firing squad. But the more I look at that now, I'm going, wait a minute, are we going to run the world on the paradigm that they ran it on?
No.
You know, and it's good to project a little bit. I mean, maybe it's a fantasy now, but at some point we have a choice. We either do seize control of our world system again and return it to some form of righteousness, or I frankly think that we're in for a planet slaughterhouse. What do you envision in terms of that happening, and what happens when we do it?
Okay, well this kind of goes back to timeline one and timeline two, because mm-hmm. we are faced right now with two scenarios, which one could be our worst dystopian nightmare of World War III and the planet dying, and a world that you wouldn't even want your children to live in because it's so horrific. But again, we can't cave into fear, and we can't project that either, because what we have to project is that we're gonna overcome this, and that there are gonna be these mass arrests of these criminals, and they're put on trial. They're not subject to the lynch mob, but they're dangerous individuals and they need to be put away. I think we can all come to an agreement on that. And then we have the opportunity to articulate how we want our civilization to progress. And these are the chapters that I examine in Future Esoteric in the Utopia section. And one of them, which I feel very passionate about, is the end of money. So even if we seize back control of the Federal Reserve, even if we can do it in a way that's completely fair and equal and without debt, maybe we still don't even want it. Because look, I use examples of Star Trek often because I think it was given to us in little glimpses.
And oh, I do too, yeah. Roddenberry was...
He was working with psychics.
The Nine, yeah.
Council of Five, and, right. and they were doing some telepathic communications, and he was sitting in on some of these sessions. And more importantly, the powers that be needed this information to get out because that was the beginning of the secret space program. And if people ever did find out, at least they could have some back excuse saying, hey, well, we gave you these Hollywood movies of a futuristic... Well, keep in mind that in Star Trek, in not one scene in any of the episodes on TV or in the movies, was money ever used. Never. If you said, I feel like having a chocolate shake, it just comes out. There you go. Drink it. You never see any money exchange. It's not in the picture. And in the future, it won't even be necessary. And this is what a lot of people have criticized me for, thinking this is just impossible. You can never have, I mean, at least have a barter system. But the one cool thing about Burning Man is the entire event exists on the gift economy. There is no money exchange. And I'll tell you, I have done camps there and been the bartender and gave it all away. And I'll tell you, there's like a little part of our brain that responds to charity. And it makes us feel real good. In fact, researchers, and I include this in the book in the End of Money chapter, have concluded that when you are charitable, it stimulates the brain in the same way as if you just did a line of coke or drugs. I mean, you can see that the brain is lighting up and you get this overall great feeling. If you just smoked a joint, as if you just gave a dollar away to a homeless guy. So I try to do that. Anytime a homeless guy asks me for money, unless I'm rushing to get by, I'll take a moment and here you go, man, wish him well. It's an opportunity. I think it's a gift. It's a challenge to us as well. If you are presented with an opportunity to be charitable, will you do it? My answer is yes.
The consciousness of money itself, it seems... You know, when you go back to some of the teachings, even the Bible says money is the root of all evil. But this idea that somehow we have a commercial system, a system of profit, right. a system that is built on ever increasing profitability, markets expanding, which we know none of this is sustainable now. We know that it can't be accomplished in real values. It has to be done through fiat currencies and now fiat digital currencies that basically only exist for microseconds as blips in the computer. But the consciousness behind it is what interests me, of being able, you use the term utopia, that chapter in the book, but utopia seems like a fantasy, whereas somehow or another, it seems to me, and as a writer, I'm sure you're trying to do this, of poking people a little bit to imagine outside of the concepts of money and capitalism and consumerism.
Right. And throughout all my books, the subconscious context of what I'm saying is just consider what if. What if the Vikings made their way to North America, as I pointed out, in Sacred Place in North America, and got far deep into the continent and left the Kensington Runestone there? Mm-hmm. What if? Is that so inconceivable? They're master navigators and they can follow the stars and get around? What if? What if the end of money were a possibility? Would you embrace it? Even if you're rich, so what? What do you need it for? All we need it for is to get what we need in life. Well, what if that was all communal and free and open? You go to the supermarket in the same way, you just get whatever you need. You know, you don't waste. Wasting's ignorant, but you get what you need. You get a house over your head. And okay, let's say somebody doesn't want to participate. Let's say somebody says, I'd rather just play video games all day. Okay, do it. Knock yourself out, kid. here's a dorm room to sleep in with a bunch of other dudes that just want to play video games. You guys can stay up all night. You can even smoke pot if you want. Don't do anything. And knock yourself out. But hey, if you want to move up and maybe get your own apartment or move in with a woman and have kids, we're only asking that you give a little back, because we're going to give you a house and we're going to give you more stuff. And if you want more stuff, how about, you know, 4 hours a day, not even a full work day. You like to hike? I love to hike. Hey, how about you go and volunteer and help us work on some trails once a month? I'd say, sure, I'd love to. You know, and so the capacity to get things done will still be there. And when you put it in the way, you're not forcing anybody to work, but you're giving them the opportunity to seek out whatever kind of work they want to do, I think it'll get done in even a better way than it's done now.
Well, you just hit on an important concept there. Everybody has something they love. I mean, even video gamers, I find some of the most fascinating people to be video gamers because they're imaginative. And if they're really good, they want to design, they want to program, yeah. they want to build out a world, which means they have the power of vision. In my experience, I've never met anybody that didn't have something deep down inside they loved. Most people have been cast into an economic system that forces them into roles based on an education system, based on these ridiculous personality tests, IQ tests. I mean, you know, you look at some of the smartest people I've ever met barely have the sense to get out of the rain. And yet I've met autistic people who were brilliant. And so the secret is that everybody contributes in the end if it's channeled properly.
That's right. And if we ever do imagine ourselves as being some kind of off-planet civilization like Star Trek, we're going to have to find a way to love each other. We're going to have to find a way to pool the resources, because let's face it, that the planet only has so much that we can exploit, and over-exploitation does no good either. If we're going to vision a world that will be sustainable for our children, grandchildren, 1,000 generations from now, we have to think about a way to do it so we're not fighting wars over resources anymore. I mean, this is really antiquated type of thinking that we could go in and conquer someone and steal their stuff, whether it be oil or slaves back in old days. I mean, the means of acquiring resources through force is something that's very old in this world. And like so many other poor ways of thinking about it, we just have to discard the old and embrace the new. One of the ways we're going to embrace the new, let's say, for example, we can release free energy technology. Well, guess what? The drought in California is moot. It doesn't even matter if it was geoengineered. We got a giant ocean out there and water everywhere, but nothing to drink, like the old pirates used to say. Well, we can just, with free energy, water the deserts and make this planet a garden again. But what we're up against, and I know our time's kind of winding down, so I want to make a couple conclusions here. What we're up against is a concept of keeping us in a box, of keeping us in a position that we're doubting things, that we're doubting even ourselves. And that's where they want us to be. They want us to be willfully ignorant and think that we're free and not pursue our God-given rights to expand our consciousness, live a healthy lifestyle, help other people, and basically drop out from this maniacal system that keeps us so attached to money and all the other things that we think we need. We don't need them. What we need is a mutual understanding going forward and embracing all the people, giving animals rights so there's no more killing whales. We're basically protecting economic regions. And I'm not talking about Agenda 21 or something really nightmarish, but a way that we all have a say in matters. So voting to me is when we all know that the system is completely transparent, completely open, and we can vote on matters that are local, that are in the region that we live in. I don't even like to say countries anymore, because patriotism, you know, it's an us versus them kind of scenario. Or we can vote on things that matter to the world. And if that day could come in our lifetimes, Randy, I would be very satisfied of saying we came from the dark ages and we entered the light.
Many people sense that whatever we go through next is going to be rapid. We live in the age where the rapidity of information is nearly light speed and instantaneous. The changes are coming at us fast and furious now. We know, you've written about it in your book, the global elite are very prepared right now to pull the trigger. They have to. Yeah. At the same time, something's holding them back. I mean, look, I've read the stories, you've heard the stories as well, about the fact that they go to set off a nuclear missile, and boom, they're disarmed.
Right. You know,
the ETs came in, they basically went, okay, this far, no farther. I think we have allies. I think we have intelligent life out there that in some way is kind of guiding the planet, but I think permissibly they're not allowed to interfere with us beyond a certain point. But we're coming to the place where we're either going to self-destruct or we're going to self-govern ourselves according to the better laws of the universe. Somewhere in there, feel free to jump in and riff.
Well, great time to use another Star Trek example, that the concept that they promoted on the show was the prime directive, that when Star Trek came to another planet, they weren't allowed to interfere with the progression, or if it was a very primitive state, they weren't allowed to intermingle and take those people to another place that they shouldn't have been. That's going on here too. And you're absolutely right. There are many times we've been at the brink. Maybe this planet would have already been destroyed in the last 50 years had some of these madmen had their way. And believe me, they're still trying. And if you know about the HARP mechanisms, that they can heat up the ionosphere and then target it down, that they may even try to like have the Yellowstone super cauldron go off, things like that. But they won't be allowed to do that. So we go to the brink time and again, but we're still progressing on the timeline one. And I think that is the evolution of our species to do that. And nobody has a right to nuke another country and send them back to the Stone Age, because we have the flow behind us. And it's sort of like the way a river flows down its course, that it's very hard to make a river go in a different direction. It's very easy to keep the flow going in the direction it's going. And the direction humanity is going is timeline one. And if we're prepared for this, we can start doing things like having our chakras activated. How about this? How about we start a new curriculum in college where we do start to teach how to become telepathic, how to levitate ourselves, how to start adapting some of these superhuman abilities that I read about in India by Paramahansa Yogananda, called Autobiography of a Yogi. Every chapter was about a certain superhuman ability. And that stuck with me. It's like, well, why can't we do this? If these masters could do it, we should be able to do it. So a new kind of curriculum, a new way of thinking, a new way of embracing life with love, and with compassion, and with the concept of saving this place, not seeing it destroyed. Then, only then, do I think that our benevolent space brothers and sisters are gonna come down and say, okay, we're ready to join you with us in this great confederation of planets. Until then, they look at us like the Planet of the Apes. I mean, look at what we're still doing to ourselves.
Yeah.
Well, why would they want to get involved? We have to evolve, but they will not let us go into full-scale thermonuclear war. So I don't think that's on the table. But they are, these elite are looking at different ways to get out of it, because they know it's their heads or life in jail if they get caught. And let's face it, there's 130 some underground bases that they're all ready to scurry down into. And you know, I have a whole chapter on underground bases in Future Esoteric. They're there, and they have great technology down there too. But it's not going to go that way. We're not going to have Armageddon. I don't feel it.
What I want to get your take on the singularity, this idea that we, and what worries me about this is that I think too many people are embracing this. It goes back to our original conversation at the beginning of the show on tech. But this idea of transhumanism, the idea that somehow the man-machine interface is the answer to all this, what is your take on that?
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, because I have a whole transhumanism chapter in Beyond Esoteric. These are concepts that I haven't covered yet, but are very, very important to know. And again, we're talking about a double-edged sword. We're talking about technology that could help us become these superhumans in many different ways and live a more healthy, longer, fruitful life. On the other hand, there's things like GMOs, and there's things like cloning and genetically splicing other entities or whatever into our genome. We have a perfect genome as it is. There's no reason to tinker with it too much. Okay, sure, we can have our Google glasses and with a little menu that we can, that stuff's kind of fun and cute and novel, but it's not really what transhumanism is all about. Unfortunately, the end goal of transhumanism is changing us into humans 2.0. And that may or may not jive well with people. And it may also come to a point, this is a concept I was just exploring with some friends. There could be a split of humanity. There could be those who have the wealth and the ways and the means to use this technology and even have their children with the right kind of genes that they want and evolve into maybe even big-headed grays. Maybe that's our destiny. I have some concepts in future.
That's distressing.
I know we're almost out of time here.
Yeah. You got as much time as you need.
These are concepts that we cannot dismiss so easily. And the other part of it is, there could be humans that are going to devolve, that are actually going to get maybe even more primitive, maybe even more Neanderthal looking. Who's to say? But there could be a split in humanity in the coming future, unless we can make some kind of big breakthrough and get this global elite out of the picture and really embrace all of humanity for what it is.
Yeah, I don't think the issue is the human biology. And quite frankly, I know for a fact we have faculties, we have genetic codes that are switched off. That was done deliberately.
Yeah,
there has been tampering with the human biology, both by off-world factions and people on the planet. Those are things that I see as being resolved rather quickly once we take back the governments, the financial systems, the political systems, and begin to reassert ourselves as the proper masters of our human domain, not what the military wants for us. Their human domain right now with Jade Helm.
Right.
One more topic I kind of want to put at you. This is kind of a topic I've explored for years, but it's gotten considerable speed now. CERN.
Mm.
What you see it as, what you think is being planned to happen there. Anything that you know in terms of projections regarding the Large Hadron Collider?
Well, again, what we're being told it's used for and what it might be used for could be completely two different things. The dark side may have an opportunity to basically open time and space and allow more of these malevolent ETs to come pouring in, which my understanding of the Philadelphia experiment is what happened. And I do cover that in future esoteric. But like you said, with the nuclear bombs, I think they're not going to be able to make this happen for the main reason it's not meant to happen. And this is our prime directive, that our future is this flowing river going down the course of the river. The Hadron Collider is kind of like diverting the river off to another way. And if they're working interdimensionally with the potential of making this planet more accessible to gray aliens or Draco or some of these malevolent ETs who wish to control us, then they're doing nothing short of playing God here, and that should not be allowed. And hopefully the benevolent ETs will continue creating these little rifts that go wrong. And so it never quite worked properly. Remember, they didn't have the mirrors quite right, and that took a few years to resolve. So maybe it'll just go on and on and on like that, and then the thing will never quite work right, and for good reason, because it could potentially be very dangerous. Maybe even like Stephen Hawking said, the planet buster, if used incorrectly, could go completely.
Found that quite incredible that Stephen Hawking came out and said that. I mean, he's actually, here again, Stephen Hawking's evolved over the period of years that we've watched him in the public eye. I was kind of amazed at some of the statements he made regarding that, and the fact that his views on things seem to become more humane than I think they were originally. This from a man who, frankly, is partially a machine himself. I mean, he owes his mobility and his speaking to technology, and yet he seems to become more human over the years as we watch him. I think that's fascinating to me.
Talk about transhumanism. I mean, he wouldn't be alive unless there was technology to make him do this. Now, his viewpoints on aliens, I took a little, I had a problem with. He said that we wouldn't even want to meet them. Well, clearly what he's referring to, and maybe all he's been briefed on, are sort of these, the grays or the Dracos.
The Dracos, yeah, the reptilian.
Yeah, they're doing the human abductions and this sort of thing. And I would agree that we wouldn't want to meet them in that scenario. But I think he's doesn't know the full picture, that there are good and bad ETs in the universe. I mean, we live on a planet of full duality. Everything is duality to us. And it kind of makes sense that it would extend out to the universe. Now you could say, well, how could some benevolent society ever overcome the obstacles? Kind of like in the book Contact by Carl Sagan, the first question Jodie Foster wanted to ask is, how did you become mature when you had all these toys that could have destroyed yourself? And the answer is, the universe has all the time in the world. And I'm sure there have been civilizations that have gotten to the point that we have gotten right now and destroyed themselves. But there are a lot of other ones that didn't. And I would agree, that would be the best question to ask a benevolent society, is how did you get over the technology hump? And in many ways, this is why I started World Peace Through Technology, is to have this discussion, to say that there are technologies that we need to get rid of. And say goodbye to nuclear bombs. There's no reason to have them anymore. We know what they'll do. But there is good reason to have technology that could restore the health and vigor of this planet and the human species as well, and animals too. I never look at any of the big picture here without including animals. And I would love the UN to issue some kind of mandate giving animal species rights, because there's no reason anybody with a gun should be able to go and kill an endangered rhinoceros. It's just, to me, that behooves the progress we've made in the last few decades towards becoming a more open, understanding, compassionate society.
I actually have begun, and it's been a long process for me, because I came, frankly, from people who were into farming, of understanding how we relate to animals has a very large linkage back to our own humanity. And yeah, I mean, I now realize that we don't really have a sustainable system when creatures on this planet are subject to the kind of brutality that we've put them under. So, you know, that's one of those things that I think we all need to address.
Yeah. Probably going to be that we're all going to become vegetarian sooner or later.
Yeah.
I mostly am for conscious reasons, but look at the way animals are treated. You know, these feedlots, CAFOs, they call them. You see them driving down the I-5 to LA, just hundreds of thousands of cattle just getting bigger to go to slaughter. And the way that pigs are just in cages and can't move, or chickens that never see the light of day and also in a cage. And the way that
we're poisoning ourselves. I mean, the hormones, the drugs that are pumped into these animals, even given the agrarian cultures of the past, we're not there anymore. We're into this big pharma Monsanto model of synthesized biology for consumption, which is wrong on so many levels. But from a conscious standpoint, I think we evolved that. And I also see it that, look, I've been told that the food replicators are out there, the technology exists, that, again, as we realign our economics, our morality, our spirituality, bring ourselves into balance and our planet with it, all of this technology then steps in to address the issues that would stand in the gap for how do we feed ourselves? How do we feed 8 billion people or 10 billion people on the planet? Well, the answer is a lot of this works out as we shift our priorities and our consciousness.
Yeah.
Final closing minutes here. I want you to just wrap up what you want to leave us with in terms of CCC publishing, your books, your activist work, and the Street Fair event, and where people can contact you.
Sure. Well, I invite people to explore the books that I've written. And as you mentioned, CCC Publishing is the best place to start. If you want to learn more about me and what I work on, I have a website, bradolsen.com. World Peace Through Technology is on WPTT.org, or Peace Tour, which is a project I would love to undertake someday, and that's getting a couple electric vehicles and doing events around the world and bringing us all together. I mean, it can't happen now, but it could happen before I expire. And How Weird Street Fair is howweird.org. We won't have our next event until next spring, but you can keep up on that, and I'll still be the event producer for the next few years. So this is my way of giving back. I believe very strongly in service to others, and this is the way I prove it. I have to work all day doing this street fair. I don't get to go out and enjoy it, but I know 20,000 people do. So that's how, if anybody's hating on me, I say, hey man, I'm living what I say. And if you don't believe me, come to the How Weird. And I invite anybody listening to do that. If you want to hear about my early beginnings traveling around the world for 3 years, a website called stompers.com, also the name of the first book I wrote, and it's still in print, as I mentioned earlier. You can also follow me on Facebook. I'm a public figure now, and Brad Olsen is the best way, I think, unless somebody knows a few friends. Facebook doesn't allow people to like me anymore, but they follow me on both of my profiles.
They don't allow people to like you anymore. Oh, that's right. You're kind of maxed out. Yeah.
Yeah, you kind of get maxed out.
It sounded
out.
Kind of horrible the way you said that. It's like, nobody's allowed to like you anymore. Like,
no, I mean, I like everybody, but they basically have a limitation on how many friends you can have, as you know, and but you can follow people in infinity, I guess. But I do like hearing from people, and you can, if somebody wants to get in touch with me, they can figure it out. I don't want to really want to give my personal email or phone number or anything, but I make myself available. Let's put it that way. I also have a YouTube channel called Esoteric Series, which I have the book launch for future esoteric and modern esoteric, as well as talk I gave on the peace tour and how weird street fair origins. So you can follow me there. And then I have Facebook pages for Esoteric Book Series, Sacred Places, 108 Destinations, CCC Publishing, as well as How Weird and World Peace Through Technology. So anytime I come into content or that are in support of any of those subjects, I'll put them on those sites. And I even do an animal consciousness raising site called Ending the Dolphin Massacre in Denmark. In the Faroe Islands, they're still mass slaughtering whales and dolphins, and that breaks my heart. So I'm trying to raise some awareness on that and still do posts about animals and animal rights, and hoping people will wake up to the fact that we're going to lose them if we don't save them. So
yeah,
that's what I do.
You certainly left a lot of breadcrumbs on the ground for us to follow, and we're glad we got a chance to like you, Brad Olsen, on this show tonight. Facebook be damned, we did it. It's been a gas talking to you. You have a voice and a home here anytime you'd like to drop back in, and we'd love to talk to Leo Zagami sometime as well. So
yeah, I'll make that happen.
That would be very cool. My guest, Brad Olsen, CCC Publishing, and all the good things that they're doing over there. Future Esoteric is the book we mostly talked about tonight. And by the way, once esotericism ends, we go into another consciousness. I'm Randy Moggins. This is Off Planet TV. Truth is out there. It's inside you. We'll be back with another show probably in about 2 weeks. We'll see you then.